It's not a single disease. It means a whole spectrum of diseases, which ranges from cancer of the mouth or the oral cavity, what we call it as, the cancer of the nose and the paranasal sinuses. This also comes under head and neck cancer. The posterior part of the mouth or the oropharynx, which includes cancers of the tonsil. Then we come to the cancer of the throat or the voice box. The upper part of the food passage or what we call piriform fossa or upper esophagus. All these come under the term head and neck cancer. Apart from that, we have cancers of the neck, which includes thyroid cancers. So as you see, there is a whole spectrum of diseases. But in India, especially when we use the term head and neck cancer, we commonly refer to oral cancers because the burden of this cancer in India is huge. So as many as 80,000 to 1 lakh people get diagnosed with various cancers, especially cancers of the oral cavity. And this accounts for almost 60% of the oral cancers in the whole world. So in many ways, you can tell India is the captain of this cancer in the world. And the sad thing is the burden of this disease is immense. The person is left hugely incapacitated. There is burden on the family, the financial burden, rehabilitation of the patient. So these are all the problems which a person with head and neck cancer comes across. See, unlike many other cancers where the exact cause is not known, in most of the head and neck cancers, there is a clear culprit, and that is tobacco. As many as 60% of the head and neck cancers can be attributed in one way or the other to tobacco. And in India, this is especially true because tobacco is consumed in different forms. First, there is what we call the smoking form of tobacco. If you see, there's a huge population in urban areas which smoke cigarettes. As we go to rural areas, people smoke BDs, which is equally harmful. And in each state or union territory, there are people who consume smoking tobacco in different forms. Apart from this, we have the other form of tobacco, which is chewing tobacco. It's almost a culture in India to use this chewing form of tobacco, whether in the form of paan or zarda. It's considered socially acceptable, and we see people doing it in functions. And this consumption of tobacco in the chewing form is a known etiological agent for cancer. Now, apart from this, there is the other culprit, which sometimes is not highlighted enough, and this is alcohol. People consider that consuming alcohol in this one is safe enough. Yes, it is safe in moderate quantities, but if a huge consumption of alcohol, especially if a person who smokes also consumes alcohol, he is at increased risk for oral cancer. Then there is a new etiological agent which has been discovered maybe in the last few years, and that is the human papilloma virus. And this usually has a sexual transmission. The other important thing is oral hygiene. It's a well-known fact that people with poor oral hygiene have increased susceptibility to oral cancers. Then we have other chronic irritants like a sharp tooth, which the person has not bothered to take care about, and immunosuppression. But the main thing here is tobacco, both smoking tobacco and chewing tobacco. These are the main agents for cancer. So if a person smokes or chews tobacco or consumes alcohol along with this, he is at increased risk for developing oral cancer. Like I said, head and neck includes a whole spectrum of cancers. So the symptoms can also be very varied. So if we take oral cancer, the most common way of presentation is an ulcer. We must be aware that not every ulcer in the mouth is cancer, but an ulcer which does not heal within a specific period of time, say within a week or two, should require more evaluation. The other form of presentation is a lump in the mouth. Sometimes it can present as loose tooth or an ill-fitting denture. As we go posteriorly, that is the oropharynx or the throat, we get other symptoms. Like a voice box cancer may present in change in voice. So if an elderly person newly has developed change in voice, we should be suspicious that he might be having voice box cancer. The cancers of the hypopharynx may present in difficulty in swallowing, especially if it involves the upper part of the food pipe or the esophagus. Apart from this, some cancers can be totally asymptomatic and the person may present with a lump in the neck or neck nodes, as we call it. And when we evaluate or we do a check, we may find the primary or the original cancer. So these are the various ways in which the cancers of the head and neck present. Whenever the previously mentioned symptoms are there, or the patient has any of these symptoms, that's ulcer in the mouth which is not healing, change in voice, some sort of ulcer which is bleeding on touch, or difficulty in swallowing, he needs to be aware that there is a possibility. Not all of these symptoms will point towards cancer, but he does need to consult a doctor. Usually, it's quite rare for the person to go to an oncologist directly, but he should consult his local ENT doctor or a dentist, and depending on the suspicion, he may be referred to a cancer center where he is being seen by a person much more experienced in oncology, like a surgical oncologist or a radiation or a medical oncologist. So this is the way patients normally present. So the doctor, he has to consult his primary care physician, and later he may be referred to a cancer care center. The different types of head and neck cancers are cancers of the oral cavity, which begins with the lip, the external lip. Then as we go inside, it may be cancer of the jaw, the lower jaw or the upper jaw. Then we have what we call cancer of the buccal mucosa, or the inner aspect of the cheek. Now this was what comes under oral cancer. As we move posteriorly, we call that area as oropharynx, and this includes the base of the tongue, the tonsil, the pharynx. So this again comes under head and neck cancers. Then as we go up, we have cancers of the nose and the paranasal sinuses. We have cancers which come in the base of the skull. And as we come down, we have cancers of the voice box. As we go posteriorly, we have cancers of the hypopharynx, or the upper part of the food pipe or esophagus. Apart from this, we have cancers of the skin which present in the head and neck region. Then we have cancers which occur in the neck, especially thyroid cancers. So these are the various cancers which come under the umbrella of head and neck cancers. Yeah, most certainly it does. Head and neck cancer treatment is extremely complex. So it requires quite major surgery, and the chemotherapy and radiation can also be toxic. So if we are dealing with an elderly person with the head and neck cancer, we need to see what comorbidities he has. Does he have heart disease? Does he have a lung problem? And what is the treatment which he can tolerate? So our decisions are based on these. So we might choose for a less radical form of surgery or a less radical form of chemotherapy and radiation in an elderly person as compared to a younger person. The choice of chemotherapeutic agents will also change depending on the age. So age certainly does play a part in what treatment we are going to offer to the patient. Like any other cancer, head and neck cancers are also dealt by a combination of surgical, medical and radiation oncologists. And a multidisciplinary approach is a must. What we mean by that is that when a person is diagnosed with any of these head and neck cancers, he needs to visit the oncologist, and the three oncologists, that is surgical, medical and radiation oncologists, need to sit together along with the pathologist and the radiologist to see what is the best possible treatment that can be offered to the patient. There can be some difference of opinion regarding what can be the best possible approach, but this can be sorted out with a proper discussion between the doctors, and this offers the best possible treatment to the patient. So without a multidisciplinary team, I would strongly discourage patients from taking treatment in that particular institute. Yeah, they most certainly do. We have many ongoing clinical trials, both in India and abroad. So most of these surgery has more or less reached a peak where the surgical procedures have been standardized. But there are many ongoing clinical trials which especially pertain to the extent of resection which must be done and how the neck must be addressed, the lymph nodes in the neck must be addressed. Coming to chemotherapeutic agents, there are a whole new bunch of chemotherapeutic agents which are being tested, especially the newer targeted therapeutic agents like cetuximab or nivolumab. So there are many agents which have been which are being tested in trials. Radiation too, there are many different regimens, whether the treatment giving hyperfractionation or more number of fractions of radiation in a day, shortening the overall treatment time. So trials are ongoing regarding this. So many trials are there, and as the results come over the next few years, there will be some clarity regarding these. When we treat head and neck cancers, we are dealing with one of the most important organs which is required for speech and swallowing. So more than what diet the patient needs to follow, we need to concentrate on what diet he can tolerate. Because most of the time when we treat a patient with oral cancer, it involves removal of part of his mouth or part of his jaw, which might hamper his ability to chew food. So we might have to prescribe him a diet which is much softer, which he can swallow. Also, during radiation also, there is severe mucositis. There is dryness of the mouth, there is irritation of the mouth. So the patient may not be able to tolerate spicy food or acidic food. And we might have to give him something which moistens his mouth. Chemotherapy too causes a lot of dehydration to the patients. So we do advise them taking lot of fluids. Overall, it is very important that during the course of treatment and soon after, we maintain proper nutrition and maintain the weight of the patient so that he doesn't have to discontinue the treatment in between. So diet certainly has a bearing on the outcomes in head and neck cancers. The treatment of head and neck cancers can be severely debilitating. It involves removal of major portions of the mouth, which of course in one way cosmetically it is disfiguring. In other ways it can hamper the speech and swallowing of the patient. With the newer modalities, we can go for extremely good forms of reconstruction like a microvascular free flap or free fibula, but still the problems do exist. And when we deal with other parts of the head and neck, especially voice box cancers, in certain times we may have to go for removal of the voice box, which will mean a permanent tracheostomy, that is a hole is made over the neck through which the patient will have to breathe. So all this can lead to severe disabilities to the patient, which we need to be aware of. Quite a bit of it has reduced with the modern technology, but the problem does exist and can be severely incapacitating for quite a few patients. Follow-up is definitely required after completion of treatment because we need to evaluate the patient for recurrences. Recurrences are fairly common when we talk of head and neck cancers. And second, the patient has what we call second primaries. So since there is, when he uses tobacco, it's not just one area which is affected. There may be other areas which are precancerous, which may go on to become cancer. So even if the patient has been treated for one cancer, he needs to be on regular follow-up to detect recurrences or to detect the possibility of a second primary. Normally the treatment it may vary from patient to patient, but by and large we prefer to see the patient once in 3 months in the first 1 or 2 years, and if he is okay during this period of time, we increase the frequency to once in 6 months. So normally the period of follow-up is almost up to 5 years, beyond which we advise a follow-up once in a year. Head and neck cancers are curable, especially if they are treated in early stages. The treatment results have improved considerably over the last few years with better modalities of surgery, chemotherapy and radiation. At the same time, it also remains one of the most deadly diseases. Like I said, almost 80,000 to 1 lakh people are diagnosed in India, and almost 50% of these die within 1 year of diagnosis. So it's a very deadly disease. It has good treatment with fairly good results, but it depends on the stage. Early cancers especially are very much curable. Patients with head and neck cancers undergo quite major resections. So the things that they are usually bothered about is cosmetic disfigurement, which will mean loss of the jaw, or the next thing is difficulty in speech. Speech disturbances are fairly common after head and neck cancers, and we require the help sometimes of speech therapists. And then swallowing disturbances, again because of surgery, because of radiation, long-term swallowing disturbances are known. So there are quite a few long-term disturbances which can happen after head and neck cancer treatment, which need to be dealt with appropriately, involving concerned doctors or the therapists.